Thank you for joining us for First Person Conversations with Holocaust Survivors. My name is Bill Benson. I have hosted the museum's First Person program since it began in 2000. Through these monthly conversations, we will bring you firsthand accounts of survival. Each of our First Person guests serves as a volunteer at the museum. We are honored to have with us today Holocaust survivor Peter Feigl to share his individual account of the Holocaust with us today. Peter, thank you so much for your willingness to join us today for this First Person program. Peter, you have so much to share with us, so let's get started. Please tell us, as a way to start, please tell us when and where you were born and a few details about your early life.
Yes, Bill, I was born on the 1st of March, 1929 in Berlin, Germany. My father, Ernst Feigl, and my mother, Agnes Feigl, were living in Berlin at the time in what I would call a upper middle class family, quite comfortable. And my father was a graduate mechanical engineer. He was born in Vienna, Austria, working in Germany. And as you can see in the picture, my father was very elegant. Summer times were spent going to the seashore or traveling to Switzerland or Austria. So things were very nice. In 1933, when Hitler came to power, I was 4 years old. And this is where I was inundated with the propaganda music that came out of the radio with a lot of martial music. And I found it all very exciting. And I should add here that my father was absolutely secular, wanted nothing to do with organized religion. And I had no idea at all that at some time I would be considered Jewish. So Judaism was something I knew nothing about at the time.
Peter, from Berlin, your family then moved to Vienna, Austria in 1937. That was a big move. How did that impact the way you were raised once you had moved to Vienna?
When we moved to Vienna, which was my father's hometown, of course, he was very happy. He had two sisters living in Austria still. And my mother and father at that point had a conversation, and they decided that since Austria was 95% Roman Catholic, had a long tradition of anti-Semitism, remembering the ranting and ravings of Hitler back in Germany, my parents decided that it would be a good idea to have me baptized. And so I became a Roman Catholic, went to my first communion. There I am in my beautiful communion suit in Vienna. And for the first time, I went to catechism, learned about Catholicism, and from that moment on, I considered myself a Catholic.
Peter, your life, of course, would change dramatically when your family fled to Belgium after Germany annexed, that is, seized control of Austria in March 1938. Why did your parents decide to leave Austria? As you mentioned, Vienna had been your father's hometown. So why did they decide to leave Austria? And then what did that mean for your life and for your parents once you arrived in Belgium?
When Austria was annexed in March of 1938, my father very, very quickly, within a matter of 10 days, decided that we had to leave. I think he realized now that he is now considered a German citizen and is subject to German Nuremberg laws against the anti-Jewish laws. And he also had incurred some of the disfavor of the Nazis while refusing in Berlin to cooperate with some of their efforts to circumvent the Versailles Treaty that prohibited Germany from acquiring aircraft engines. So we left one suitcase each, and my father was able to do this because he had multiple entry visas to a number of countries, including Belgium, where his company had an office. And once we arrived in Belgium, of course, I was very distressed at the time. I'm 9 years old. I had to leave behind my electric train set and my toy soldiers. And on top of that, I find myself now in a country where I had to learn two new languages, French and Flemish. And of course, I was too young to realize that my loss was nothing compared to what my parents lost. They left everything behind, all of their belongings, furniture, silverware, crystal, paintings, you name it.
Peter, before you go on, I'd like to take you back to Vienna for just a moment. We have a photograph of when Hitler came into Vienna himself, and that was very relevant to you personally. Will you describe this scene for us?
Indeed, be glad to. This was the 2 or 3 days after the annexation. We heard that Hitler was coming to Vienna. I was very, very excited about this. I heard he would be speaking near the city hall. Went away from home and joined in that mass of people there. There must be over 100,000 people. I'm in there somewhere. And we were all shouting, Ein Volk, ein Reich, ein Führer, one people, one empire, one leader. And I was looking at the Hitler Youth parading in those snazzy uniforms that they had. With that uniform came a dagger. And oh boy, did I want to join and get a dagger. And when I got home about 4 hours later, my mother was beside herself and a little bit furious. And she said, where in the heck have you been? And I said to her proudly, I saw our Führer. Whereupon my mother slapped me left and right and said, he is not our Führer. And don't you ever forget it. I was very confused at the time. I really didn't understand yet.
You now are living in Belgium. And your father sounds like he was just remarkable, as you explained. He refused to cooperate with the Nazis and therefore was blacklisted. Now you're in Belgium, a neutral country. Was your father able to resume his business, your family resume your life, and how safe did they feel in Belgium?
Well, as I mentioned, my father's company had an office in Belgium, so he was immediately employed. I had no problem with that. And rumors of an impending war were already circulating throughout Europe at that time. And my parents were very happy to be in Belgium in a safe and neutral country that wouldn't be involved in the war. And despite the fact that we now were living in a small furnished apartment, after leaving all our possessions back in Vienna, at least the family was together, and things went quite well when the war started in September of 1939. Again, my parents felt, well, we have nothing to worry about. We're here in Belgium, and we are safe and sound.
And of course, all that changed after the war began in September 1939. The following spring, in fact, in May 1940, Germany attacked Belgium. And at that point, your father was arrested. Tell us what you remember about your family, about your father's arrest and your family's response to his arrest, and how that led to your remarkable journey to France.
Well, on the 10th of May, when Belgium was attacked, my father decided to go to work and see to it that his employees get paid. He was arrested by the Belgian authorities when they had an identity check and he pulled out a German passport. He was, of course, immediately suspected of being a German paratrooper or a fifth columnist, and we were able to locate him about 3 days later. He was in detention. And my father said to my mother, look, take Peter and your mother, my grandmother, my mother's mother, who was also in Brussels at the time, get out of here. You don't want to get caught between two armies. You have the Germans coming from the east and you have the Allies, the British and the French, moving northward towards Belgium to try to help the Belgians defend themselves. So we followed his advice and we joined hundreds of thousands of refugees. You might have seen some of that in newsreels of the days. The roads were clogged with refugees carrying whatever they were able to carry, suitcase, backpacks, and so forth. We were being machine gunned about every 20 minutes or so. German Stuka dive bombers would attack the roads, not necessarily to kill the refugees, but to block them, the roads, so that the Allies could not come to the rescue of the Belgians. And when that happened, we would jump into the nearest ditch And I, 11 years old at the time, could only think of one thing. When I grow up, I want to become a pilot and be in the cockpit of an airplane and da-da-da-da-da with a machine gun. That must be a lot of fun.
That must have been a profound experience for a little boy to what you were experiencing, as you describe, much less what your parents and the rest of the refugees were feeling, tremendous fear and uncertainty about their future. Despite all the terror of that fleeing from Belgium, you made it to Paris. But once in Paris, your mother said, "We've got to go south." What happened from there? What did you do?
Well, as we arrived in Paris, air raid sirens sounded. My mother said, "I didn't come here to be bombed." So we managed to get on the train and went to the south of France, the south western coast of Bordeaux, where my mother, as law-abiding citizens would do, immediately went to the police to register and to try to get permission to stay there. And the French policeman said, "Well, I don't know what to do with you. You're a German. You married an Austrian, which makes you Austrian, but there's no more Austria. And you're here with your mother and with your son, and you don't have a visa. You come from Belgium." Said the same thing there. And so they sent her to the prefecture, which is the civilian government in that sort of a county government. And the other man said, "Oh, you have to take a train and go to Oloron-Sainte-Marie near the Spanish border. We have experts, they know just what to do with you." So we took a train, and when we got to Oloron, the train was surrounded by French gendarmes with machine guns. They loaded us into trucks, and half an hour later, they dropped us off into a French detention camp called Gurs. Gurs was an awful camp, had a total capacity of about 14,000 prisoners. It had been built about 2 or 3 years earlier to hold refugees from the Spanish Civil War. You see a picture of it there. There were a muddy path in there. Barracks held 60 people in each. There were no cots or beds in it. We slept on the floor on straw. Notwithstanding the absence of the beds, we still had bed bugs, fleas, and body lice. There were no sanitary facilities in the barracks, just one cold water spigot outside to clean yourself. And toilets or latrines were located about 200 yards away. They were just open pits with a beam across them. It was an awful place with no food. We received lukewarm water called coffee in the morning and one slice of bread. At lunch, you had lukewarm water with, if you found a couple of slices of carrots floating in it, you were lucky. You had some vegetable and you got another slice of bread. And dinner was a repeat of lunch. So everyone was hungry. With the lack of sanitary facilities and the absence of decent food, a lot of people were dying. There were cases of dysentery, typhoid, and so forth. So it was a horrible situation, and everyone just dreamed to get out of there in some fashion.
In fact, you were able to get out of there. You spent, I believe, 6 weeks in Gurs, and you and your mother were released, and the two of you relocated to the town of Auch in France. What can you tell us about her being released and then how you made your way to Auch?
Well, my mother, a very strong-willed woman, when France surrendered to the Nazis on the 22nd of June, shortly thereafter, a German army inspection team came to see who was being held by the French. And my mother decided to bluff her way out of there. She rushed forward to the German army officer holding her passport in her hand and shouted that, "Heil Hitler, I am a citizen of the great German Reich. I've been held by these no good lousy Frenchmen here with my son and with my mother for the past 6 weeks. I demand to be released immediately." And the German officer looked at the passport and told the French camp commander, "You call a taxi for Madame." And 20 minutes later, we were in a taxi heading north. And we wound up in this town called Auch. And this is where my story takes an important turn, because we ran for the first time into people who did the right thing and helped out. It was a Catholic nun in a convent. where my mother rang the doorbell. The nun, after hearing our story, decided to put my mother in touch with a food distribution center in Osh. This center was operated by the Swiss Red Cross and American Quakers. It had been organized about 2 years earlier to help refugees from the Spanish Civil War. And so with a part-time job offer, she was able to get police permission to remain in Osh so that we could rent a small room there. But perhaps even more importantly, she was able to bring us home some food every day. It took us about 2 or 3 months to locate my father. It turned out that he ultimately also wound up in Gils. Of course, we didn't know it at the time. And he was finally given a convalescence leave in March of 1943, March of 1941, because he had developed heart trouble. He was 54 years of age at that time already. So the French thought that he probably wouldn't survive, so why pay for his burial? Let his wife take care of it. So he was able to join us under the Vichy laws, which were even more restrictive as far as Jews were concerned than the Nuremberg laws. My father was, of course, prohibited from working. It was very difficult for them. He tried to earn a few francs by doing some illegal work, cleaning spark plugs and so forth. But at least the family was together in that one room apartment, which literally was living room, bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, all in one place.
So there you were together, reunited again. Your father's not well, but you're together as a family, and you would remain together for, I think, about a year. And then in the summer of 1942, you were sent to a summer camp run by the Quakers, but while you were away, while you were at that camp, your parents were arrested and deported to Auschwitz. When you heard the news of your parents' arrest, how did you respond? What did you know about the whereabouts of your parents at that time?
By the middle of 1942, rumors were circulating that Jews had been arrested and rounded up in the occupied zone of France. And I'm 13 at that time. I really didn't fully understand what that meant. And my mother was able to get me into this summer camp operated by the Quakers. The camp was about 20 miles away from Osh. And the director of that summer camp was a devout Catholic lady, Mrs. Cavaillon, who took me almost every morning with her to 7 o'clock mass. And she had no idea that under the Vichy laws, I was considered Jewish until on the 27th of August. All of a sudden, she called me into her office and said, "I'm very sorry, Pierre." I was called Pierre then. "I just got a letter from Osh. Your parents were arrested yesterday on the 26th, and I don't know where they are and what's happened to them, but don't worry, I will organize a novena, and I'm sure that at the end of 9 days of prayers, your parents will be restored to you, and I'll be looking after you." And about 2 days later, the French police came to arrest me. Mrs. Cavaillon succeeded in bluffing them and making them think that I was much too ill to be moved. And also, I should mention that on that 27th of August, I started writing a diary dedicated to my parents, because I was convinced that it was only a matter of time before I see them again. And I wanted to record on a daily basis what I was doing, and to show them that I behaved and did exactly as they would have expected me to do.
Peter, you told us about the start of your diary in order to be able to share with your parents when you saw them again all that you were feeling and what you were doing. We have an image of the opening page of your diary. Will you tell us what these pages say? And then, if you don't mind, read some excerpts for us from your diary. This is written almost 80 years ago by you.
Right. I wrote in the diary, I started off by saying, this diary is intended for my dear parents, in the hope it will be reaching them both in good health. And one of my first diary entries on August the 27th said, "The mailman was here. I run to see if there's something for me. Praise the Lord. A postcard from you telling me that you're together in the Camp du Vernet. I'm happy, and I hope you will be released in view of the dad's poor health." And later on September the 1st, for instance, I wrote, "The start of a new month. I wait to hear from you." And then on September the 3rd, 1942, I wrote, "I'm deeply concerned. Mrs. Cavaillon has received a letter with my baptismal certificate, three shoe ration coupons, and nothing else is written. The letter is written in great haste. I'm worried. I fear that you have been left and that you left me."
I had the privilege, as you know, Peter, of reading your diary, and thank you for sharing those brief excerpts. It's so painful and poignant to read that there you are writing with the expectation that eventually they will read this diary, and you talk about each day not hearing from them and how that made you feel. Peter, with assistance from the Quakers, you arrived in Marseille on October 6th, believing that you would be leaving on a ship bound for the United States, but sadly that was not to be. On November 10th, Allied forces landed in North Africa, and Nazi forces occupied all of France, including the unoccupied zone where you were, which of course then stopped all ship traffic leaving Marseille. With this escape route, this door out of France closed to you now, where were you able to find shelter from that point?
As I wrote in the diary, when I realized that the ship was not going to sail to America, I said, "Goodbye, America." I figured it would be curtains for me at that point.
I just have to say, Peter, when I read that, that was so powerful. Just you simply wrote, "Goodbye, America." That is exactly what you wrote. It's incredible.
Yes. I realized that this is the end of my dream, and it would further separate me from my parents. I was still hoping somehow that we would be reunited in the coming days. But now the Quakers had the problem of what to do with the children, that there were some 500 orphans that they were allowed to send to the United States. Now they didn't know what to do with them. So I was being bounced from one orphanage to another, until January of 1943, when the rumors began to circulate in Marseille that Jews were about to be rounded up and arrested and sent eastward for resettlement, as a euphemism, resettlement. No one really knew what that meant. So I got instructions on the 15th of January to be ready at a moment's notice. I would be given instructions to take a train. And I ultimately arrive at midnight in a village high in the mountains, about 3,200 foot elevation. January was ice cold. The roads were covered with snow and ice. And I was met by a young man named Daniel Torkme. I had no idea where I was. And after a two-hour hike, I dropped in bed, dead tired, in a home, not knowing where I was. And the next morning, I sort of got oriented, and I discovered that I was in a village called Le Chambon. And this is a most unusual village, Le Chambon-sur-Lignon. I was one in a group of some 24 kids in a home called Les Grillons, which was managed by Daniel Torkme. In that picture that you see, I am the boy sitting on the far left in a dark suit, always smiling. That's me there. And so I learned that this village and the immediate area was inhabited by Protestants who were a real minority in France. France is about 95% Catholic, and these Protestants who in their past experienced persecution in the 16th century when they were persecuted by the Catholics and slaughtered. There was an infamous St. Bartholomew massacre in Paris where some 10,000 Protestants were killed. They found refuge on this plateau. And they are people who are fundamentalists and who follow exactly what the Bible tells them to do. And they were inspired by their pastor, by André Trocmé, who, when France surrendered to the Germans, advised his congregation to fight the enemy with the weapons of the Spirit. And with those words, they understood what was expected of them and developed what I might call a conspiracy of goodness. Some 3,500 inhabitants in that village managed to save and hide some 3,500 refugees. Most of those refugees were Jewish. They considered the Jews as being people of the book. There was a documentary made many years later by also entitled Weapons of the Spirit, where the producer of the movie asked one elderly lady shuffling towards her temple, and tell me, madam, why did you do this? This was very, very dangerous. It was against the law. You could have been executed for helping Jews. And she is holding a Bible in the crook of her arm, and she taps it, and she says, well, it says in the book right here, that if someone is sick, you go to the bedside and you bring them cheer. If they're hungry, you ask them to table and to share what food you have. If they need shelter, you open your door and you take them in. So for these people, this was the natural thing that to do. They did so without trying to enrich themselves, which many farmers during the war were able to do. And the entire community and surrounding area was named by Yad Vashem as just among nations, because this is unique in the annals of the Second World War of so many people doing the right thing and saving so many people.
Peter, in your diary, you mark the end of 1942 and the start of 1943 with photographs of your parents. And I think we have an image of that. But soon after, your diary just suddenly ends as of the end of January 1943. Why did you stop writing in your diary?
Well, it was confiscated by Daniel Trocmé shortly after I had arrived in Le Chambon. It ends abruptly on the 31st of January. Because he saw me writing in it, and he looked at it and said, if this falls into the hands of the Gestapo, the secret police, or the French police, it would be curtains for a lot of people, because the diary contained many names, addresses, dates, and so forth. And that is why the diary stopped abruptly and disappeared for many years.
Do you recall what you felt when Daniel Trocmé took your diary from you?
Honestly, no.
No, okay. And if you don't mind, Peter, because Daniel Trocmé played in that short period of time, he played a big role in your life. What happened to Daniel Trocmé?
Daniel Trocmé was the cousin of the pastor André Trocmé, the one who inspired the entire community to do the right thing. Daniel was also the director of a second children's home in Le Chambon. This was a home that had older boys, 17, 18, 19 years of age. And in June of 1943, the Gestapo came and arrested those students. They were all Jewish. And Daniel tried to go to their rescue and try to save them. Police, the Nazis arrested him. Wouldn't let him go. They absolutely couldn't understand that a non-Jew would bother to try and save these Jewish children. And ultimately, he was killed in Majdanek, one of the Nazi death camps. he wrote a very, very touching letter to the children of Les Grillons, the home where I was in Le Chambon. He sort of knew it was his one of his last days. He was a great, great man.
Yeah, thank you for that, Peter. Peter, you stayed in Les Chambon for 10 months, and in September 1943, you were sent to a boarding school in Figeac. Tell us about your time in Figeac and the preparations that were made to get you out of France and hopefully to safety.
Well, in while in Le Chambon, I was provided with false identity papers. My name was changed from Pierre Feigl to Pierre Fesson. My date of my place of birth was changed from Berlin to Auch in France. And I was instructed that if I'm arrested and I'm asked about my parents, I'm to say that they died in a bombing raid. And I was sent to this boarding school, a high school in Figeac. And the idea behind that was that the people in Le Chambon wanted to make room to take an additional refugees and also to give us an opportunity to continue with our studies, going to school. So I arrived there in Figeac around October of 1943, and I began writing my second diary on the 1st of January of 1944, where again I was recording daily the events that occurred in town, what was happening to me, and so forth.
Was your audience at that time, Peter, when you started the second diary, did you have specifically your parents in mind as the principal audience?
Indeed, I continued to write the diary essentially to my parents.
To your parents.
I was still hoping that someday I would be reunited with them, that I would see them again.
I wanted to ask you now to tell us about the escape that you did make from France to Switzerland in late May 1944, and you would remain there until 1946, a year after the war. Tell us how you got to Switzerland, and when did you feel actually safe?
Well, starting with, again, described in my diary, I got involved with some of the French underground. Some of that French underground were actually Jewish boys in their early 20s, and they claimed to be Boy Scouts. We punctured tires of the German army trucks in the schoolyard. We poured whatever little sugar we could find into their gas tank to prevent them from going out and hunting for partisans and underground people. And I also had cooperated with them and translated some German documents that they found. So on the 12th of May of 1944, a German SS division, Das Reich, marched into Figeac and ordered all the males between the ages of 16 and 54 to report to a labor detachment. I had gotten a little bit smarter by then than I was when I was in a ditch looking at the dive bombers. And I realized that I better hide. So I hid in the bell tower of the adjoining church and spent the next 24 hours up there. I could watch in the distance the trucks being loaded with the men who reported as they had been ordered. And when I came down the next day, I found, for instance, that the other four boys who came from Le Chambon with me, they had disappeared. And Jewish underground contacted me and said, look, it's too dangerous for you to remain here. We're going to see to it that we put you in safety, get ready to leave at a moment's notice. Again, all of this is described in my diary. And shortly thereafter, on the 22nd of May, following the instructions I got, I got off at a railway station called Viry. I didn't really quite know where I was. There were about 20 other kids on that train, but none of us knew one another. We were strict under strict orders not to congregate. We were met by passeurs. These were people smugglers who were paid to help people go to the Swiss border. And they instructed us on how to cross, when to cross, where to cross, and so forth. Point, I drew a sketch of that crossing. You can see France at the bottom and Switzerland is on the top part. And there are two rows of barbed wire fences. We got over the first one, had to run through the no man's land to the Swiss barbed wire fence, get over that. And once we were over that fence, a Swiss border guard appeared and arrested us and told us to get behind the building. So we were then loaded onto trucks and taken to a triage center outside of Geneva. And on the way, we were looking at the food displays and grocery stores and so on. We saw oranges and bananas and all kinds of things that we hadn't seen in years. We were salivating. Anyhow, in the triage center, we were to be interrogated. And as each one of us was called in for interrogation, someone whispered in my ear and said, be very, very careful what you say. They're sending the Jews right back into the waiting arms of the French and Nazis on the other side of the barbed wire fence. So during the interrogation, I pulled out my baptismal certificate. And when I showed that to the Swiss,
that you'd been carrying secreted on your body for quite a while, right?
Yes, actually, the people who organized my escape had sewn it in the lining of my jacket.
Wow!
So I had to undo the seam and pull out the folded baptismal certificate and presented it to the interrogator. When he looked at it, he said, ah, mais tu es catholique, bienvenue en Suisse. Ah, well, you're a Catholic, welcome to Switzerland. So with that, my neck was saved. And literally for me, my running, my hiding, my under false identity ended on that day. There's a mugshot that the Swiss did of me and gave me a refugee identity booklet. And for me, the war was ended about 2 weeks before the Normandy landings in June of 1944.
Peter, did they in fact get sent back?
Out of the group that I was with, no. But about 10 days later, another group of children was on that route towards Switzerland. And the same woman who was in charge of sort of the mother hen to look after them had already been picked out by the Gestapo. They were waiting. She and the children were arrested. And the mayor of Annemasse was able to save about, I think, 20 out of the 30 children that she was escorting that time. The others wound up killed in Auschwitz, and the lady who was looking after them, Marianne Cohen, was tortured for 3 days and executed and killed. Mm-hmm. So it was a close call for me. 10 days later, I would have been one of those.
You got that diary back, the one that was confiscated by Daniel Trocmé, but you got it back.
So in the 1980, 81, 82, the company I was working with, we were sued by the Algerian government. We needed an international attorney. I was advised to go and find one in Paris, someone named Samuel Pizarre. As I was telling him what the problem was, he said, gee, you speak French very well. Where did you learn your French? Well, I learned in Belgium and in France. We're in France. Well, I learned it in Arche, in Le Chambon-sur-Lignon. Yes. And he said, well, I have a cousin who's a movie producer, and he's about to do a documentary about Le Chambon. Can I give him your name? And I said, sure. So this movie producer, Pierre Sauvage, contacted me and asked me whether I would appear in the documentary called Weapons of the Spirit. I have a small part as I'm driving from the town of Le Chambon up to Les Grillons, the home where I was at back in those days in the 40s. And when that movie ultimately was shown on on French movie screens, theater screens in late 1987, 88, I received a letter from someone in Paris, a Monsieur Diamant, and he asked me, "Are you the Pierre Feigl who dedicated a diary to his parents?" And I thought this was some sort of a scam, but at the time I was going to Europe just about every 5-6 weeks. So I stopped in Paris, and sure enough, Monsieur Diamant has my diary. "How did you get my diary?" He said, you know, "I'm a collector of such memorabilia. I bought it on a flea market in the south of France on the Côte d'Azur about 2 or 3 years after the war. And by the way, I also published it in France about 2 or 3 years ago. Well, I wanted my diary back." And so now he pleaded, and he said, "Well, I'm a poor man. I had to publish it at my own expense." Make a long story short, I had to buy my diary back, and I paid him $265 for it. I'm still chafing at the bit for having to
I got it back. But as it turned out, a good investment on your part.
Well, I think the most important thing is to do, at least in my opinion, to do what I am doing, what I have been doing since about the early 1990s, and that is to speak in schools and to speak to teachers. Many states have mandated the teaching of the Holocaust, but the teachers know very little about it. And we, the surviving survivors, we're, as I said, I'm 92. I'm not going to be around much longer, but the message is that there's a message that we can convey, especially to the young people, to the students. And when I speak in the schools, for instance, I try to tell them how, in my instance, I knew nothing about Judaism. I knew nothing about religion. And in my first grade in Germany, I was taught to hate Jews. And I believed my teacher, who told me that Jews were bad people. They lie, they steal, they cheat. They're like vermin. They should be exterminated. You want nothing to do with them. So you have to be taught to hate. And as I got older, I have noticed that in many countries around the world, unfortunately, there are leaders in dictatorial states, as it was in Germany, for instance, where the leaders, for their own survival, need to put whatever blame that they deserve onto someone else. So they need a scapegoat. Hitler, for instance, picked on the Jews. They represented less than 1% of the total population in Germany at the time. But he blamed the Jews for having lost the First World War. They supposedly stabbed the German army in the back. If it hadn't been for that, Germany would have won. There was a hyperinflation. Blamed the Jews on that. There was a depression and unemployment. Blame the Jews for that, or any scapegoat. So this happens too many times, and Hitler got away with it by putting the blame on a minority, and also promising the unemployed a job. "I'm going to make you proud of the country again. We'll become one of the most powerful countries in the world. Just follow me. I'll put you in a neat uniform." People bought into this, some of them in desperation. So when I speak in schools to the students, I ask them, you may be asking yourself, what relevance does this have to you? And the answer is this. Each and every one of you in that school has either been bullied by someone, was the bully, or has witnessed someone being bullied. This is a typical example. You're being picked on by someone stronger, and make that bully feel better. The next time that this happens, it is your duty to immediately stop it. Why should you stop it? I give you two good reasons. The first one is because it is the right thing to do. And everyone knows right from wrong, whatever your beliefs, wherever you come from. But if that isn't enough, I'll give you a second good reason. And then second one, I would call it, is survival. Survival, why? Survival, because the day may come, let us say here in the United States, where there may be massive unemployment, there may be another a depression as there was in the 1920s. And when that happens, a leader might arise who will again need to have a scapegoat. In your school, you may be the one who is part of that minority. It may be because you speak with a foreign accent. It may be because of the color of your skin. Maybe because you're wearing the wrong clothes, or whatever the reason. You have freckles and have red hair. That makes you the target.
Peter,
that is why you need to stop it.
Thank you, Peter. I know we're right at the top of the hour. I wish we had the rest of the afternoon to spend with you. Thank you for being willing to share all that you've said. It's been profound. What a remarkable story you are sharing with us, and important lessons for everyone. I want to thank our audience. I also want to thank our sponsors, particularly the Lewis Franklin Smith Foundation, for all of their support, and with additional support from the Arlene and Daniel Fisher Foundation.